calling up Carl Pope. He's here. He's the artist that put together this exhibit about Mari Evans, who is a local poet and intellectual and Renaissance woman. I don't know how else to describe her. She can do anything. So this exhibit, I'll let him talk about, and this is Carl Pope.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Wow, I'm just like welling up. It's been a hell of a week, right? And so in light of what's going on this week, I want to talk about this show. I think Mari was a woman before her time because I think she, in her appendices of the book Clarity as Concept, talked about the various waves in that has happened in Black cultural production, from the Black Harlem Renaissance to the Black Arts Movement, and then to the transitional, what she calls the transitional period. And this week, with what has happened with, like, I saw Moonlight twice this week, what's happening as a response with the election, what's been happening in the last couple of years. Not only has Mari mapped and talked about the regressive elements in society, but she's also mapped and talked about and sort of predicted the multi-level, multifaceted, like, renaissance is happening with, like, Black feminists, with Black LGBT activism, with the founders of Black Lives Matters, with Black girls dreaming, with the tenderness that I saw between men in Moonlighting, to like amazing sort of like explosion of like brilliant contemporary critical thought that I feel that Jillisblack is a part of, and with that, I don't need to say anything more. Let's just give it up for Jill.
Carl, I'm not always there when you call, but I'm always on time. All right. How is every, hold on, let me look at you for a second. That's awesome. Okay. So, in case you don't know me, my name is Jill. Just Jill, there is no is black on it all the time, but for today, there actually is. There's lots of people who are like, is that your real name? And I'm like, it actually is my real name. But I want to get started by talking a little bit about how I got started. So if you followed me for a really long time on social media, then you know for about 2.5 to 3 years, I just wrote captions that were too long for people to want to read. And then some people did want to read them. And we started from there. At some point this year, I realized that there was more that I could be doing, that there was more that I could be saying, and that I needed to reach more people. And so I did this thing that I now call being revolutionarily honest, right? Okay. So when I say that, what I mean is I know that black people are not being honest with white people. That's it. Yeah. And I wanted to figure out a way to say that, right? So that being said, I want to give a little warning. If you are not familiar with my work and you are a sensitive person, it's great to be sensitive. All of my exes wanted that from me. I would encourage you to either A, try here, or B, know that this isn't for you. But understand that I will not mince words, because people are dying. So I wanted to read something because I looked to see who was coming and knew that I could. And the reason that I got started is there's this elephant in the room for me that people seem to want to bring up. And there are a lot of white people come into the comments and they'll say, like, you're not even actually black, you know that, right? No, I don't know that. I have two black parents, and also all the time you call me black. But in this moment right now, conveniently, I'm not black suddenly, right? But I think that really what white people are trying to say to me is that there's a betrayal taking place, right? Where the elephant in the room is, I've been in a lot of white space. And you can tell. And you can say that. More creatively than you are right now in the comments, to be honest. Say that to me, right? And that is true. And I think a lot of black people find themselves in these white spaces right now, right? And there's something that goes on when you find yourself in those white spaces. And when you are trying to come out of that and be revolutionary, sometimes what you have to do is you have to write these letters to white people on your Instagram. But now we're gonna actually do one in person. And it's called What Now? So the question is, how do you come back? How do you come back from self-hatred as a black person, right? Because we are living with that all the time. And sometimes we are not even cognizant of the fact that it is there, right? So I sat and I thought about every single day, how am I participating in white supremacy? And when I say white supremacy, I say that because people know what that is, but what I really want to say to you is, I'm participating in my own destruction. Every single day. I go out, I do things we deem as normal, and those things that are called normal are actually me participating in my own oppression. Every single day. Let's start there. So I say, what now? How do I come back from this? How do I earn trust? Because here's something really fun, white people. Black people have their own hierarchy. What? Yeah, yeah. We have our own stuff going on where you can get thrown out of the black community for fucking this up, right? We see it all the time in social media right now, right? So we're also dealing with not only getting it right for you over here, but I have to be trusted by black people if I want to do this work. And that is an intricate game in a society that encourages you to be white and untrustworthy to your community. So, how do I take this self-hatred, this betrayal, and make it worth something? How do I recycle this waste? White people, this is where you come in, right? This is where the long monologues where I claim to know you come in, right? And if you haven't seen that, I would love to cue not this video in that black turtleneck, but the other one if possible. Do I have control over that? I'm not good with the technology.
Okay, white people, would you please stop doing that thing where you come on and you say, like, okay, I see what's going on here. Just say it. Like, just say that you hate white people. Okay, just say it. Like, we all know that that's your way of saying that you can't confront any information that differs from the information that you currently have, and we get it. But I don't know, like, I'm not gonna answer that. You answer it. Should I hate white people? Like, if I could take all of your oppressive characteristics and all the ways that you benefit from my oppression and put them into a person and then date that person, then come to you for advice and be like, hey, I need advice about this person. Would you be like, oh yeah, you should totally stay with that person who uses, like, non-consensual violence and mind control and imprisonment and torture and then lies to you and says that's actually not happening at all and then says that they love you and they love you because they love all humans and also asks you to, like, hold them and comfort them while they cry about all the ways that they hurt you. Like, you should totally stay with that person. Is that what you would say to me? Because if so, that makes you a shitty friend. Are you a shitty friend?
Right. And then white people get upset with me. And I don't get it. But I do know you. A lot of black people know you. And we have to know you because this is how we play this game. But understand that it's a game, right? So I mean it when I say that because I had to. This is how we survive in your world. If we want to drink the self-hatred necessary to desire your approval above the approval of other black people, we must lie about who we are. We must replace it with you, so we watch you. Some of us are more observant, more detail-oriented, and thus some of us are better at it than others. I was very, very good. Let me be clear. I was really good, okay, at playing this game. And you don't have to pretend that you can't tell. I know you, and not just one type either. No, I could mingle. You like me. You like me. You trust me because I sound like you. And I know your gestures, and I know who Parker Posey is. And I've seen Mystery Science Theater 3000, like more than one episode, and that makes you trust me. And I know all of your shit, right? And there's something familiar about me, and that makes this easier. Because I want black people to understand that I am definitely followed by more white people. Every day. Why? So it was my job to know who and what you were talking about. I was the black person that you did not have to meet halfway. I came to you. I knew your shit, and I trained on it. And so, when it was time to figure out what it was my job to do here in this, what is my role in this change, I knew that I had to join the Revolutionary Planning Committee. There is a potluck attached to that. I don't know if we have a potluck here today, but subcommittee, intel and analysis. Everything I know about you is going to be said to black people. Everything. Every single thing I've got. Because we have to know what we're up against. Right? Okay. So, if black people are going to figure this out, one of the biggest things that I talk about is this idea of revolution and how exclusive it is. Right? That a lot of black people feel left out. They don't know their role. We don't know where we belong in something that is so abstract that people get to decide, no, not you. You don't fit here, right? So whether that be for being presumed as biracial, whether that's for being queer, whether that's for ever having touched a white person in a photo that you found from 2011, whatever it is, suddenly, no more. You're not ready. I get a lot of messages from black people writing me saying, I appreciate you because now I feel included in this. We can't do this exclusively. It's not going to work. And as we throw each other away, as we go on Facebook and we say, I'm about to educate this white person in the comments, and here we go. Also, please stop educating people in my comments. If you're here and like you're doing, like stop, I can't anymore, I can't watch it. And we stop and we say, okay, hold on. So I don't know if you know this, but there's this thing called, and then we start explaining. Let a black person come on your timeline and say some fucked up shit. Unfriend. Where is the education for your black friends? No, you've offended us, we're done, we're done. Whether that be in the media, whether that be on social media, mess up and be black, and black people are like, no, come better, we're done. Okay? So we'll spend all of this time in the comments saying, okay, white people, like, I just want you to know this isn't about hatred. It's like basically just about like coming together, and we just have to figure out how. What are we talking about? But let me tell you the most important piece. Here's what I know about my community. I know that we're not saying everything. We're not saying it. And I don't want to read another think piece until we start saying it. I don't want to read another article until we're ready to say it. What are we not saying? That shit that we're saying at home. So if you are going to do the job of educating white people, how would you start by just saying theories? That's why. You're just talking in theory. I don't know what anyone is saying anymore. And I certainly know that there are a lot of people that that information is not accessible to. So all this black girl magic, we can just talk to each other in one giant circle. Just exchanging all this information with people who already know it, people who've already shared it, people that you talk to every day. We all know the same people. We all follow the same people on social media, and we're going around in a circle. So what is the good in that? Is that accessible knowledge once we're doing that? We know that it's not. We know that it's not. We know that we just want to talk. We have all this rage and all of these student loans. And somebody's going to listen to us say these words that we learned. Somebody. I don't care who it is. Someone's going to hear me say white supremacy today. Because I learned it in a class. So, what are we not saying? That should be scary, white people. What are black people not saying to you? We're not saying what it's like every day, actually. We are not saying what we give up every day, actually. We are not saying how we conform every day, actually. We do not tell you, hey, you know nothing about me, actually. Nothing. Because I cannot bring my full self and survive here. It's not an option. Understand that I cannot bring myself as a person, this human race that you love, that you want us to all join unity, we're gonna do it, okay. How? Because I can't even bring myself in a conversation with you at work. So there's a platform. And I think about that. And I think, what are you gonna do with this? I build every single video in layers. If you get it, if you bout that life for real, you're okay. So that's what you're getting from it. If you need to feel inspired, if you need to feel validated, if you need to see that someone else is like, uh-huh, yep, this is happening, you can get that too. But I want it for everybody. I don't want it just for people who look like me. I don't want it for people who also just are interested in Afropunk photos. I don't want it for just people with hoop nose rings. I don't want it for my genre, my subcultural bullshit genre that you register me as because of how I look. Not just that, because that's what we're doing. We're playing that game too. That's black hierarchy. I want you to hear it from someone like me. Because the laugh is that when you go into my comments and you say, you just hate white people, you're just making generalizations, you don't know anything. Oh yeah, I do. I've tried it. This isn't coming from nowhere. This is coming from white space. And it's toxic for black people. Do you know who Avant is? That's white supremacy. And I don't have to have a theory for that, right? So I started this work. I am a cultural competency trainer and facilitator. Laughable, yeah. For 5.5 years, I went around with my mother. We were a dynamic duo. And we spoke at nonprofit agencies that catered to foster and adoptive services. We would go in and we would talk to staff and we would say, how do you go into the homes of people of color and how are you being culturally competent? And there's like a version of that that's mostly a lie that I would give you and I would instill some hope. And I hope that you would get something from it. And that you wouldn't go in and say, I read this about you and I know that you like dot, dot, dot. And I have done so many of these. I have done over 500 cultural competency trainings. I don't know. I've seen the patterns. I've got the survey. I know how you show up in those spaces. White people, what can we do? Stop defending yourself and start defending us. How about that? Stop defending yourself and start defending us. This is a mess. You don't know how we got here? Black people can tell you how we got here. All week long, I've watched white people say, I don't get it. I don't get it. How did this happen? Because she, black people. This is what the country looks like to us all the time. We are in a constant red state. It's always red for alert. I was raised in Alabama. So I'm also not gonna let you just keep going with, it's those people in the South and they just vote against their own interests. Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania? Y'all saw the map. Does that make it more real? That's everywhere. That's not just the South. And I'll tell you something else. There is a lot of meeting of cultures between black and white people in the South. We don't have that anywhere else. So before you talk about them voting against their own interests, let's look at liberal politics. What is that? I feel like I should ask the question, what is liberal politics and what has it done for me? Raise your hand if that's done something for you in your everyday life. That's the reality. We are actually dying. Hold on. We are actually dying. We are actually dying. This is our real life. We are dying. We're dying. It's not social justice. It's not a social justice issue. I don't want you to read enough to get it. We're dying. I don't have time for you to read enough. It's obvious. I have a 20-year-old brother. Colorism isn't helping him. He doesn't benefit from that. What do you want me to say? I'm worried for him every day. Every day. That is the reality. And as I worry about him, I show up to my 9-to-5. And I watch people cry because suddenly something has changed for them. Do not say that to a black person anymore. That's infuriating. Nothing has changed for us. It's maybe more obvious. That might help. Right? So I did this work. I got frustrated. And I realized today that this is the first time that I've ever gotten to show up and say what I mean. Because as a black person, you don't get to do that in a lot of spaces. And for some reason, I get to do that today. And I'm gonna take advantage of it. Mm-hmm. So, revolutionary honesty, and why is it important? And what do I mean by that? Just say it. Just say it. Stop burying it in words that you got from your oppressor. Talking about oppression in the language that your oppressor gave you. No. I have a minute to get a message done, so I use white supremacy because it's faster than what I want to say. But what I really mean is, you can't even have your personality without my oppression. You have words to describe personality types that are literally from my oppression. What does it mean to be whimsical? I don't have time for whimsicality in my life. What? Whimsical? That's from oppression. We're trying to make it, and we're dying, and you're whimsical. Miranda July. Yeah, I know her too. If things like that, that basic, are coming from white supremacy, here's my question. How does it benefit white people to defend blackness? It's that frustrating question. Why would you? If you're benefiting from it, why? How do I make you fight against something that you're benefiting from? I mean, like, would I? Like, I really have to think about that. Like, would I want black people to not be oppressed anymore? Like, things would start changing. And I get these letters, these DMs, rather. I'm sorry, that's antiquated. I get these DMs from white people saying, Jill, I just wanted to reach out to you, and I wanted to tell you that I'm so mad today. I woke up, and I was so upset. And I thought about you, and I wanted to let you know that I'm so grateful for you doing your part to make the world a better place for my children. What the fuck did you just say to me? To make it a better place for your children? My God, what are you saying to me? Do you understand how offensive that is? I'm dying? And then, like, also risking my life literally at this point because saying deciduous trees is starting a race war. I'm literally risking my life to make the world better for you? My God, how? That's some deep shit. When you have managed to take my trauma in 1 minute videos on Instagram and somehow make it benefit you still, I don't know what else to do. I also want to talk about, it's not just fun to follow me because you feel like I'm really mad. And if you can take it, that makes you better at this, right? Because there's also that, let's be honest, come on. You want it as hard as you can possibly get it. So you can feel like you got it. I get it. And I have a very commercial look. There's like a lot of things, glasses, you can draw me real easily. Thank you for everybody does that. Right, there's a look to it and it just makes it super digestible. And I'm mad and it's conflicting with what you're seeing and what you're hearing. And so that's a really intense experience of just like, yeah, she's fucking saying this. And then I get these women and they're like, you're so badass. I wanna be just like you when I grow up. You wanna be black? There's no version of this for you. Get to be this badass without oppression. No, but seriously. I want to talk about how we get to be honest. Stop sparing feelings. We're going to spare feelings into our destruction. That's what we're going to do. That moment where the white friend is saying that thing, and you're like, let me not, because if she, you know, I don't have time, and I don't want to get into that. I don't have the time to educate her on this. No, you don't have to have time. It's fucking racist, and what you're saying is destroying my community. And we don't need special words for that. And we also have to risk it. After I had the first video go viral, I woke up in the morning, and I was like, what the hell has happened? And I took 2 days, and I read through all the shit that I had to read about me, and my face, and what I was saying, and what I was starting, and how I was a victim, and how all black people are victims, because that's what they say, right? It's like, you just want to be a victim. You're right, it's so much fun. And I took 2 days and I really thought through that. I have a major death phobia, okay? And I thought, Jill, you just put yourself in the line of fire with some crazy ass white folks. Are you ready for that? When I came here, I had to think, we had to talk security. Am I ready for that? Clearly I am. Because the thing is I'm ready for it as a black person every day in this country anyway. And if you're not ready for it, you're not looking. You're not paying attention. You should be. You should be ready for it. So would I rather do it? Would I rather live? Empowered, using it, or would I just like to walk around tiptoeing and have the same fucking result? my job. People ask me about that. Jill, what is it like to go to work? Have they seen the videos? Yeah, they've seen them. It's a very big nonprofit organization that you've heard of that's really fucked up on the inside, and as soon as I quit, I'm going to tell you all about it. And they said, Jill, we love what you do on social media. We think it's so avant-garde. We're trying to figure out, we've talked to the social media team, is there a way that you could make like a national video and we could just post it and like we could use that and sort of talk about the benefits of art? No. Additionally, to the three black women that I work with who posted it on Facebook, you must really trust white people. I had an evaluation 3 months ago. It was perfect. It's not now. Every day, Jill, I don't know that you stapled that correctly. Just, this is a warning. Damn, like, I thought, okay, they'll get me. They'll get me. And then I'm gonna set up a GoFundMe. But until then, we have to. We have to. We don't have a choice. We have to do this. This is where we are. This is what's happening. Your president is Donald Trump. Your president is Donald Trump. He's a reality television star. I don't know if you've heard of him. That's your president. What option? Tell me. If there's something else I can do other than saying it, tell me what it is. I'm not gonna do this. I'm not gonna play this game anymore. I'm not gonna do this, white people. I'm not gonna pretend. I'm not gonna walk around. I'm not going to laugh. I'm not going to talk about Russell Crowe. I'm not gonna talk, that's dated, but I'm still mad about it. Wasn't attractive. We have our own standards. How about that? Yeah, let me just actually, that's not even on here. We have our own standards of being attractive. No, I don't find all these people attractive that you're mentioning to me. How about that? We do our own shit. How about that? Do you know about it? And not just what's popular, like stop with those bestsellers on public transportation that you read, kind of like this. I get it. You're reading bell hooks. We all see it. Put it down. Why is it blocking your face? We get it. I see it. You're on my side. You're an ally. Stop performing it. Start doing it. And the last piece to that would be black people. Please don't write me anymore asking for book recommendations. I don't read. White people went back like, yeah, that's clear. I don't read anymore. Because I didn't know what the fuck I thought about anything. I can't read until I figure out where I am in this. I don't want any more thoughts. Look at it, it's here. What do you think about it? Why, when you watch this video that I've managed to crunch this much shit in 1 minute, why do you need a book for that? Talk to each other. And while I'm up here just talking, there's one more thing. Please stop saying this is not your grandmother's revolution. What are we talking about? We should hope that it's our grandmother's revolution. We should be so lucky. Are we kidding? If this is not intergenerational, how do you know that this little on and popping black love shit happens every 10 years and we lose it? My mom was like, hey, Jill, I hate to burst your bubble here with y'all's little black girl magic, black excellence, Afro punk, everything's cool, it's lit to be black, all that culture we're creating. White people are like, what are you talking about? Every 10 years, Malcolm X came out in the 90s, people was lit, people got jobs. How do we sustain this? All this energy, how do we keep this as you get opportunities to advance in whiteness, right? Because I'll see people say some shit like, this is fucked up, we about to start this revolution. As soon as I get out of class in the morning, we about to fuck this shit up. Oh my God, like, okay. I get it. But say what it is, say what it is, let's talk about it. You have to go, you gotta go to class. They tell you you gotta go to college, you gotta try to get a job, they ain't gonna get you a job, you ain't gonna be able to pay those student loans. Luckily you won't be working and so you can keep doing that deferment. That's the good thing about that. Say what it is. Call that what it is. Today I'm going to participate in white supremacy. I know what I'm doing. I know that I want to benefit from it in some way. I know that I'm trying to advance in it. I know that I'm doing that to my own detriment, the detriment of my community. And I feel like I have to, because we haven't figured this shit out yet. But let's call it what it is. The aesthetics and the visuals, y'all. We are going to drown in black aesthetics and visuals that ultimately take us nowhere. All day long. Album cover. Same album cover. Okay, yeah, we're all listening to this right now? Great. Same album cover. Okay. This is what we got. We just gonna media the shit out of this, right? We just gonna keep, and then I got black people in the comments. Jill, we want you to be famous. Jill, we want you on Atlanta. Jill, we would really like it if you were on Insecure too. Why we all gotta be on one thing, okay? Jill, somebody has to see you. Why the fuck do you want me to be famous? Why? Why would you take what we are doing? Because it's not just me. Thank God for the black people that follow me. Thank God that you let me know that you're there. Thank you. First of all, thank you for being here. Why would you take that and put it on television? Why would we want it to be inauthentic? The only version of this we know is me getting famous? Off of talking about the fact that this is fucked up, we have to ask ourselves why you need me to be in white gaze winning for this to feel valid. Why? I don't want to make t-shirts besides this one. I made this one for me, but I'm not selling it. Why? Because I am watching people like me go around and start selling every fucking single thing they can. I'm watching them sell themselves to Amazon and YouTube. What is that doing for us? And why? This is where I want to be. I want to be having conversations with black people. That's what we have to do. We have to stop trying to get famous, y'all. We have to stop that. And we have to stop saying that, like, albums are gonna save us. Especially lukewarm albums. I said it. And you know what I meant. That's not gonna do it. Beyonce, that was beautiful. That's not gonna do it. That's not gonna do it, though. That's not gonna do it. So while we drown in all the visuals, understand that that's not going to do it, right? And we can call that what it is. We can say that that's self-care. Let's call it that. Let's say, you know what? I have to go to work today. I really need somebody to say a thing that makes me feel good as a black person. I'm about to listen to Solange. Just say that. That's self-care. Feels good. Great. But let's not call it the revolution, because then we're going to get confused about how to move forward. Because that's like a corporate album. Like, she performed that on SNL. I doubt that that's going to help us. Like, I feel like, you know, it can be what it is. But we're so desperate to defend our shit. And that's the part that we need to take from it. That is worth saving. The fact that black people are finally like, no, our shit. Yeah, our shit. Keep that, but let's call it what it is. So no, I don't want to be famous. Let's put that out there. Tell your friends. I want to get this done. Right? And I also can't. Because of colorism right now, y'all, it's actually good for me not to be the one on those shows. it's actually great that it's not me. You've seen me before. You don't need to see me again. You've seen me for how many years? Mm-hmm. Though I do encourage you to look around and see what you're still seeing in some of these aspects, right? Okay. So, no, not Jillisblack the brand. What do? We have to get together. We have to find each other. There's a whole group of black people that will tell you that they feel betrayed by other black people because they don't get to be themselves in black community. Where does that send black people? Where do we run? What was that? You can say, that's not the point of this. What did you say? To white people. We run to white people. They allow us to be different. That's what happened to Jill. Jill was different. Black people didn't accept Jill, so Jill was gonna be white now. Self-hatred. That's self-hatred. And I played that game hard, and I'm gonna call it what it is. I don't do this whole black people don't accept diversity within our community. We don't like, you know, thinking, we don't like it. I'm not gonna play that game. I knew what the fuck I was doing. I'm sorry, I knew what I was doing. I knew what I was doing. So I'm gonna call it that. I was fucking with white people. I liked that shit. Because I didn't know how to feel at home in my own community, and that was on me. Right? And then you begin this vicious cycle that I got to talk about last night with some black people who treated me very well when I got here, thank you very much. And it starts this cycle. Well, now you're in it. Now you're untrustworthy to blackness. You're getting really mad because you're like, black people still don't like me. Black people don't trust you because you have so much white shit going on. They can tell. We know each other. We know when it doesn't smell right. We know that. If you don't believe that you can be diverse in your own community, start being diverse in your own community. Somebody would have to start it. Let's say it's real. Somebody would have to start it. Right? So I got out of that. And that took a long time. That took years. That took years. And I had to own every single element of that and take all responsibility. And I had to think, Jill, what is your role in this now? I know what I know. I'm gonna use that, right? Because sometimes we get lost in this idea of, so should I just be out in the street protesting? Is that your role? Is that what you're good at? Figure it out. We have to figure it out. People have different skills. We've participated in this differently, right? So I could either sit here and be like, yeah, here's the part of this that I understand. I know how to gather people that feel rejected by this movement. I have to trust myself. First of all, it's hard as a black person because you're told that you're stupid your whole life. I have to trust that that's my role here and feel confident in that. I can do that. I can't do everything. There are a lot of things that I cannot do. There are a lot of things that I don't know. And there are a lot of things that I shouldn't be speaking to. So I'm gonna stay right here in my life experience. There's not one video I make that is not based on me. On me. So when it's, you see, you're just talking shit about all these black people. I'm talking shit about me. Do you get that? This is all I know. But I also know that black people have got to start saying what it is. It's important. You see that. This has been 3 months. And if you followed me for a long time, you know that this is moving pretty quickly. That's a lot of responsibility. I want to be authentic. I want to show up actually. I don't want this to be bullshit. I want to stay grounded in this. I want to be with blackness figuring this shit out. It's important. So, my answer to that is figure out what you know individually and use it. And the other thing is we need to get together as communities. We have to get together. if you haven't found a person like you in your own community, you aren't looking. You aren't looking. Find it. We have to make these safe spaces for each other. The space has to be safe. The thoughts cannot be. Okay? So, I think if nothing else, because I want to take questions, I want to say to white people, this is deeper than you think. If you're overwhelmed now, if this feels like a lot to you now, you have no idea. You have no idea. You don't know what it's like to be thrown out of blackness because you participate in whiteness. That's a line that we walk, where we have to stay faithful to a community while also trying to survive. You don't know what it's like to live like that. And navigate your own community's hierarchy, which involves many, 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 many things that you don't know about. Understand that we're doing that. So this life that you live, where you are also navigating, where you can also have hard experiences, and by the way, please stop saying to me, but my life was hard. White people can also get sick. White people can also be poor. You're right. Here's how I know that you don't see me as human. Black people can too. And they'll still be black. Us too. Those things don't, they're not the same. We also are living. I don't know how to tell you, it is deeper than what you think, and we're not telling you because you haven't shown that you can handle it. Handle it. You benefit every day, and you can't take me saying, I don't want to talk about this. It's not relevant to my life, and I don't believe it or agree with it because I didn't make this up. You did. And this is your standard. Jill, I don't necessarily think that that's true because I think that, no. Just take it. We're dying. It's the least that you can do. Like actually, are you reading the comments? I have white people telling me that slavery benefited black people. There are theories out there where people work themselves out of racism by talking about replacing negative images of people of color. I have to do this curriculum in my job that we don't want to talk about. And part of that process looks like, for white people, putting up images of black people that conflict with some of the stereotypes that they have. My God, don't do that. I bet I know what you're gonna put up. White people succeeding in making black people wanna succeed in whiteness. What are you gonna put? You're gonna put some doctors up. Black people can be doctors. Black people can be lawyers. Black people can be this. That's why it's all white. That's some white shit. If those are the images that you're replacing, that's not gonna help you. Because what you're saying is this is how black people are, and eventually they can be more like me. If they're lucky. If they can code switch. Right? Don't do that. We are balancing this every day. And as I say, you can't make it through a 1 minute Instagram video without writing me and saying that I'm divisive. I'm not divisive. I'm finally telling you what's going on, at least with me. I'm not speaking for all black people, but I'm speaking to the black people that feel the way that I do. Maybe I'm speaking to some black people here. So, that's where we are in black people. Here's a message just for you. We're gonna do this. We are. We are. We are. We can. This is not hopeless. Do you know where we fucking come from? Do you know where we come from? We can do this, but we have to be honest with each other. We have to stop throwing each other away. When somebody inevitably posts a photo of me saying, "This is Jill in 2008, with me, I'm a white person, you see she looks like she's having fun, and so she's lying to you," I want you to not unfollow me. This is part of the process. I'll own that. Yeah, I've owned it for you. It's done. Yes. I'm here now. And because I was there, I guarantee you, you can trust me. I've got a lot of making up to do. Use it. Right? I plan on using it. Because I have to. Because I've betrayed black people by thinking that their shit was better for even a second. Better. I wanted it. I use words like bougie, by the way. What are we doing? Stop doing that. Bougie brunch Sunday. Like, what? Who? Why? Why are we doing that? Why do we need to feel better than other black people? Stop saying bougie. Like, what does that mean? Like, read the word. And it also, it's a racist word. If you go on Google right now, it's a racist word. It means someone who thinks that they have taste, essentially. We don't even know, just putting bougie on everything. This need to feel better than other black people comes from whiteness. Stop with that shit. We gotta stop. Right, right. And we keep talking about these black people. We keep talking about this group, right? We have this idea. White people do it too. There's like this group of black people that we talk about. Like, these communities are hurting by, who are we talking about? Who is this magical group of like black people? We know what it looks like. We won't say it here. We know what we mean. I think our president said Pookie. Is that what he called? Yeah, he said Pookie. We don't have to get into that. Okay. We know what that looks like. Yeah, he did say it. You know what different? He really did say it. He called that community of ours Pookie in a speech. So we know what we're talking about. If your president knows, then we know what we're talking about. Stop. They're doing better at this than we are. They're in their community. It's some of us that went off to University of Puget Sound, then went off to Oberlin and majored in a whole bunch of different kinds of studies. Intersectional something. Everything's intersectional. They're in their community. They know where to go, they know where not to go, and they fuck with each other. And we keep talking about them as a demographic, talking for them with our liberal arts degrees. We don't know about that. We're buried in self-hatred. Why would the answers come from us? There is an answer that can come from us. It's how do we take that and use it? But it's not that answer. Stop trying to think that we can run this for black people. That's why Ferguson was successful. It came from the community. So stop just talking about this group of black people that, you know, that doesn't exist. They have black grocery stores, you don't. You still going to Whole Foods. I am. Because sometimes it's also hypocrisy. Every day I wake up and I ask myself, Jill, two questions. One, how are you participating in white supremacy? How? Eliminate one of those ways today. One, it can be simple. But how? Because I'm doing it without knowing it. And sometimes I'm doing it while knowing it. I need to name it as what it is when I'm doing it when I know it. It's impossible to change all of these things. We're trying to exist in society. We have bills. We have cell phones. Of course. Name it as that. Name a way you don't have to participate. Change that. Start there. The other thing would be, what am I not being honest about? And whatever it is, I make a note of it. And I make a video. That's my way. it's not sustainable. I can't keep making Instagram videos. I can't stay on social media. It will help no one. We all know that. So what I need to do next for me is go around and do this and talk to some fucking black people about what we need to do. This is what we need to do now. It's time to organize. But we have to organize in honesty, not in some theory that we studied somewhere. God, at least let it be Spelman. But that's some old community hierarchy shit that we can't even get into and colors. But the point is that that's what we can do. Just own it. Just say it. Just say it. Stop hiding it. Especially not for their benefit. Because it's killing us. Questions? I won't. Carl Poe.
Reading Mari Evans' book, Clarity as Concept, it made me feel like that what has been going on the last 10 years with, like, you know, in this society, it makes me think that there are more white people feeling that they are a part of the plight of black people with what's going on with the 1% and everything. Do you think that your following on some level feel like it's coming for them too, that somehow that what's happening to us is mainly appetizer for what's coming for them down the road, or,
I mean, there's another elephant in the room that suggests that this isn't working for white people either. It's not working for white people. Right? This system isn't working for anyone. We know that. So I think, to your point, yeah, of course. I think even this week we can tell something is broken in this system for everyone. We know that. I cannot get to white people right now. Not right this moment. I'm saying, like, in what I do, I can't get there now because I have to talk to black people. That's who I, that's my priority. But don't be fooled. I understand it's not working for anybody. Right now I'm taking a little joy in it not working. That's revolutionary honesty. There's a part of me that's like, oh, it's not working. Like, oh my God, what happened? Like, it is, Carl, but yeah. This shit isn't working for anybody. If we keep pushing capitalism, that shit's not working for anybody. But we got it. And when black people want to get revolutionary, all of a sudden we start talking about capitalism because it's working so well. All we need to do is just build up, okay. Just recreate the same system. I'm just going to recreate them and make them black. Okay. But that's not working for white people. So Carl, I think I would say, yeah, I think so. But there's a shift that needs to happen where it would have to be, this is finally happening to us, like away from that into a we. And I don't know what that looks like. I'm gonna be honest about that. That's, I mean, you tell me white people, when? I mean, you'd have to recognize me as human first. And you don't. You don't. You don't see my life. You don't see my life. I am still an accessory. I am still diversity to your experience. Diversity. Black person. You know black person. I'm a black person. I'm a black person. We do weird things. We do the same things that you do. Like we wake up, we date each other, we have whole lives. And it's not just about bringing the greens to the potluck. Like, and then having you steal them and sell them for $60. It's not just about that. You'd have to see me. You'd have to recognize actually that we had the same struggle. And that would be my question is, when do you see it not as, oh, it looks like this one, so we can steal the structure of how they've gotten change to happen over time, because I see that. I see let's steal the civil rights movement and model it for our sake. But I don't know about when it is, this is all of us. I don't think that's a question for me as a black person. I think I would ask white people, when is it all of us? Is that possible in my lifetime? I turned 30, December 4th. Got some time. Well, not if the death threats keep happening, but maybe a little time. You don't have to raise your eyebrows. I feel okay in this respect. Yeah, I don't know. I don't think that's my question, though. Yeah, I think we'd have to ask white people when. When are we going to stop being accessories? When do we stop being things for you to study? When do we stop being social justice issues that you can choose to participate in or not, that you can choose to understand or not, that you can get behind, show up to this one rally, and then run back home to participate in all the things that are working for you? When does it stop being that? That's not a question for me, but I understand the question completely. Sure. No.
Can you repeat the question?
Me? I basically asked her, when she came, because I'm not that familiar with you,
mm-hmm.
okay? When she came here and she looks out at this audience, is this the audience she was expecting to see given what she was up there doing? And her answer is no.
No, Anya. Yes and no.
Okay.
I would love to.
What did you expect to see? That's what she
said.
Oh, okay.
I love black people. yes and no. Once again, to speak honestly, I understand my appeal to white people. I speak about that very openly. I think we all get it, right? I mean, we don't have to say it, but I think that this is the kind of shit that white people like. So, yes. Yes. And yes. And I would hope, it's almost always my goal to say enough so that the audience changes. It becomes a challenge for me. This is pretty good. This is pretty good. I assume that the people in here feel that they can handle it, and I feel good about that. But it's inspiring to me. Do I want to see more black people in the space? Mm-hmm. I don't have a problem saying that. Do I always wish for an all-black audience in my entire life? I'll be honest with you, yes. Yes! All black people everywhere. How about that? Let's address that. That's what I want. I can't get that. That's why our spaces are important to us. You get that life. When you don't, you shoot it. In some communities. Not in liberal ones. You invited in to do talks. And I almost always want to be surrounded in all blackness. Let's start there. Absolutely. I'll own that for you. I love to walk into a space and see all black people. When I walk into a space, I find the black person. There's a reason. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Are black people not saying that to you? Yeah. I'm glad that you're here. I just wish you were black. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Did I expect it? That's why I needed to expound. Yes. I don't think it'll stay like this. Because I plan on continuing forward. Yes. And hello.
Hello. So in what ways do you practice self-care so that you can keep your natural product? Share some of your tips. We all know.
I'm in a legal state. Washington is a legal state. It's a legal, recreational, marijuana state.
Yeah.
A. So there's not. B. I don't know that I am. I am concerned with Black people's obsession with self-care. I'm concerned about it. I'm concerned not that it exists, but that we don't leave it. That everything becomes about taking care of yourself. Okay, this happened and I just need to take about 3 months to process and get, okay, I get it. I know. And we're staying there. You know what I mean? If I'm scrolling through social media, all I'm seeing is people just staying in self-care. So I have this rebellion against it that is unsafe because it is important. I'm just ready right now. And I think that what'll happen is I'll take some time after. But we just, Trump just got elected this week. And my ancestors are slaves. I don't know how to forget that when I want to just listen to an album and forget. Because again, it's still about where we come from. Yes, take care of yourself. I guarantee you that honesty will do that for you. I feel really good right now. I feel really taken care of just by getting to say that I wish everybody was Black. But usually I find that it's the break from yourself and your lying that you need. Waking up every day and lying is exhausting. Owning it is self-care. Making those videos is self-care for me. And I also get about 50 messages a day from Black people. I wish that for everyone. I wake up in the morning to, I appreciate you, you're seen, thank you, I love you, Jill for president, that's not revolutionary. I get that as part of this. I have 14-year-old Black girls writing me saying, I'm so happy that you exist. They've never created anything. They have never created anything that touches that. Not one thing. Nothing with my Amazon Prime account, because I want to be honest and not be a hypocrite. I do have an Amazon Prime account. And it's not helping the revolution. They've never created anything that feels like some version of me looking for me, finding me. And that's something that we all have. I wish that for every single person, and we can have it if we build community, if we say it to each other. My self-care is coming through my community, but I don't have time to sit down. It's getting worse. Anybody else? We have 10 minutes. Carl Pope.
Can you talk more about, the disconnect between language and experience and how that can come together? Because that is a project that Maury talks about that's written on the walls here, mm-hmm. how we have to find our own language. Mm-hmm. And I understand sometimes you have to put down the books because the books are not speaking your language. So mm-hmm. how can you... what was your process of coming to terms between, finding the words to speak about what you experienced?
To be fair, I have a background in writing. I have a background in drama. Okay, we get it. It's not just I woke up one day and started doing, I have a background in these things. These are skills that I have as a creative. So this is my platform because I can also do it. Right? Finding language. So every Saturday, I spend about 5 hours drinking coffee and talking with my mother. And we say everything about a thing. It starts with a theme, we keep it going, we talk for hours. I talk to her. I want to talk to Black people, and I want to use the language from those conversations. Because as a writer, there's always this insurmountable disconnect between how you would say it and how you would write it. And I try to work on that. And I also keep in mind that I want a diverse group, because there's diversity within diversity. I want a diverse group. I want you to be able to get something out of it. And I'm not just in my space, getting up my car, getting off on the fact that I'm using words that Black people may not be familiar with because they did not participate to the same level in white supremacy that I did. I'm gonna say that language. I'm not gonna say education. I'm gonna say you did not participate in white supremacy to the level that I did, and thus you may not have this language. Good for you. But I'm not getting off on being able to see how much complicated ass shit I can say, how I can be the next Black person to explain it in a way that makes, no. We don't have time for that. Just say it. Just say it. And again, I understand we went to school, there's some PhD, there's some things, and you paid for that. And I mean, that's like buying groceries and just letting them sit in there and not eating it. I get it. But just say it. And to do that, I had to practice saying it with another Black person and taking that conversation and just using that and trusting it too, because this is also about Black people trusting that we don't need it to sound like a thing, that it doesn't have to be reminiscent of some white book that you read, that it doesn't have to be some formalized version of this to be considered worthy. It can just be how we would say it. And Carl, we know how we would say it. We all have relatives. We all have safe spaces that we've said some shit in. We all have friends. We all have something where you just said it.
And it ends with prepositions.
And it ends with anything we want it to end with, as long as it starts. But y'all aren't gonna catch me in that language shit. I'm not playing that game. Like I said, I have a minute. I might replace, but we don't have time. The ego on activism?
Yes.
All these sponsored activists with their little Twitter accounts and their egos, they can explain to Black people some shit they already know in a more complicated way so that you can have it approved by a panel of your peers. No. It's not as honest. I mean, you can do it, and I'm sure you can speak to a lot of things. And we have Black people said many important things that way. I worry about the accessibility of those things, and we should be worried about that. Damn.
I have a question.
Sure.
So I'm an avid reader. I love Maya. She's one of my favorite. Maria has wrote a poem called Who Can Be Born Black, and the ending line is Who Can Be Born Black and Not Exalt, and not feel like a joyful place of being Black. In the classroom, I've had to experience, not only as a parent and a teacher or an educator, but I've had to experience parents of the students that I teach having a problem with being getting too much Black literature. Like all the books that I selected for my students this year were Black books, Black authors. And you know, I did it unapologetically. And I think the school that I worked for knew who I was when I arrived.
Right.
So it doesn't bother me in regards to that. But in regards to my students knowing who they are, then leaving a school that looks all like them and going out into a world where they do have to code switch and they do have to know how understand language, what do we say to them now in this day? You know, since Tuesday, our students have experienced something that, you know, that has been happening. I mean, we've noticed it happening way before now, but
right.
It's overt. You know, they're just going to come out and say, fuck you, you know? That's what's been happening.
Yeah.
Or when is the wall going to go up? And that's what's been happening. In Columbus, Indiana, yesterday, they had to do a march. Because, you know, the Latinos got to school and say, you shouldn't be here today, you should be building that wall, right? And so we have to figure out what do we say to our students who go out into the world and say, you know, well, I'm human, and today, you know, you have placed me in this, you know, I thought myself as human, I thought myself as beautiful, and now that I'm out here, you might not see me as such, and then how do I defend that?
Damn. I think that some of this doesn't, we don't have answers to.
Right.
Right, because it doesn't make sense. It's chaos. So the other thing is, if we can talk to Black young people and say, first of all, here's who you are. Give us the information about who we are. I think we have to start saying that we're doing things for survival. I think we have to call it what it is. You know, I think we have to let young people know, and this is the world, and this is what we're doing, and we have to let them know that it is not the right way. Because I think oftentimes what we say is, you know, this is how you, you know, you're nice, you're polite to each other, this is how we act, this is what we do. But we don't explain to them that they're doing that because they live in a world that hates them.
Right.
We just tell them that. So then they go out and that's just right. It's not survival. Can we name it for our children as saying, here are the things that you need to know to survive. They have nothing to do with what I've taught you about yourself. Nothing. They do not connect. It is not, you feel so empowered in this that you can, you know, go out and win at this. I'm sorry that you have to, but this is part of it.
Yeah.
And the reason that it's part of it is because this is who you are, and you are a threat. Absolutely, we know we're a threat. So this is why. I don't know beyond saying and owning, this isn't the right way to do it. It's simply what we have to do. And I don't know what age you can say that to someone. My mother read me slave narratives to go to bed to when I was a child. It was traumatizing. Yeah, it was. That, I really just wanted like the Berenstain Bears, but she was like, no, we're gonna read slave narratives. I struggled to fall asleep. I think that, I don't know how I feel about that, honestly. I think there was a rebellion set up a little bit. Because she didn't explain, here's why.
Right.
If I got this part of it, well, now I know. Right? Because they are going out into a world that is telling them, this shit isn't right. Subtly, blatantly, all the ways. So why? I don't know. Other than that, it's a large question that I would start, like with many things that I've said, by saying what it is.
Can I ask a follow-up question on that? With that, with going through this life narrative with your mom, and then coming back full circle to where you are now, having to go through what you went through, mm-hmm. the journey that you took, do you think that played a role in coming back full circle?
Yeah, it did. Mm-hmm. The foundation was there. And I had someone that was patient with me, and she waited when I was 16 years old and went out with my white friend, and my white friend stole, but they only arrested one of us. And so my mother, who had gone to or graduated from law school at New College of California, which is gone now, but it was a social activism school, my mother was about this life, also on a journey, and she admitted that to me. My mother was always transparent with me. She talked me through that on the phone, but she's like, but I'm not gonna show up, because if I show up, I'm gonna make this worse for you. And she waited through that. That didn't do it. That didn't do it. Being in handcuffs, having white police say, well, you're too young for us to actually do anything with you, so we're gonna embarrass you. In a small town in Alabama, which is where I grew up, Auburn, Alabama, War Eagle, and walk me around the middle of downtown to make a spectacle out of me. That didn't do it. So whatever the foundation was, it had to be pretty strong. And she waited, and she was patient, and she talked to me, and she explained why. So when it was time, when I finally was like, no, not like this, there was something to come back to. So I don't think it's all in vain. I just think that what I would have asked for was the explanation as to why and how it is not connected to this. This shit is bullshit.
Yeah.
You know, in a lot of what you've said today and the questions and all that, it's about, I hear this theme of telling the truth, speaking the truth, telling the complete truth, no matter where
mm-hmm.
you are, to whom you're speaking and stuff, but that takes courage. in human nature, we don't necessarily have that courage to be in the workplace and speak the truth to your boss.
Mm-hmm.
Or I don't even use the term boss, bad me, to your supervisor. We're afraid of what we may lose.
Absolutely.
And we've got to get over that or nothing will change.
Right. Well, there are a couple of versions. Number one, are you really ready? Because you'd say it at work, right? There's a version of this where it's just like, black people, it's time. Like, we got to do it, right? And we keep putting it off, and it keeps being this thing, and we don't even trust the people who are planning it right now because they say some problematic ass shit. And so there's that version. That's hard to speak about, where we just know it's time. And then there's the version that says, when you get the opportunity, are you being honest, right? Because that's what black people say to me. It's like, well, I can't have this job. Okay. Are you doing it when you can? Are you doing it with that friend? Right? Because, fine, I have bills too. I have a lot of bills. And I don't open them, but I know that I have them. And they call me on my phone. They're probably calling right now. It's Saturday. They call on Saturday now. Yeah, they do that now. All night, too. Just all night. So, yeah, like, I have a job. I think it's saying to other black people, because it's not always about what you're saying to white people too. So let me be clear about that. It's what you're saying to other black people. And so when I say that, I'm like, I have this job that I hate, that I'm going to for survival. The job that I work at is contributing to the absolute destruction of my community. They do that openly. They apply for grants to do that. That's what they're doing. And I show up. I say that to black people. I say it to the white people that I know I can say it to. But we're still talking about survival. You know when you can say it. You know when. And you can always say it to black people. In fact, we should, because this is self-care too, is letting other black people know that you're feeling it. Right? We know what that looks like. We know when and where. And I know that we know when and where because we do it every day. We decipher that every day. I'm way over time, I think. But I can't tell because all your clocks are fast, so. Right, no, not like in time. I mean, like specifically, I don't know if this time is fast, but I think we're good. All right, time check for you? Just as long as I want, okay, well. Any more questions or anything from white people? Okay, good. That's good.
I'm going to say one more thing. Mm-hmm. I talk a lot. Okay. But again, I look at this room and I'm probably making judgments that probably are unfair. But I would suspect that every black person in this room reads books. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And then, okay, so are you, you said that you want to see an audience that's all black. What about an all diverse black audience? Where that those people that we all want to save and stuff, they're not in this room.
See what we mean when we say black hierarchy? There's a lot going on.
Come to some agreement about where we are and where we need to achieve.
Mm-hmm.
So how, you know, I'm not going to go there, I'm shut up.
All right, so.
No, sorry.
Why are you apologizing to me? So, yeah, okay. First of all, I don't know either, right? And people also assume that they know something about me. So, let me quickly say, single parent home. Father, FOTEP, so he doesn't believe in child support, because it's a system. That's one system I kind of need. But anyway, I live in low-income housing right now. Right now. Qualify. Live in it. Love it. Especially in Washington, because it's all white, so it's nice, because like the low-income people, they're saying we're white, so it's all nice and new. I am who I'm talking about. I am simply a person that was pushed into more white supremacy, right? So this isn't the only space. This is one space. Is it important to go to other types of spaces? Absolutely. And as I was telling the beautiful group of people that I got to talk to last night, I'm followed by a lot of different people. A lot of different people. I get a lot of messages from people that some may not suspect would be here. Whatever that means. I know that you aren't as familiar, but I think if you are, you've seen the comments and there's a lot going on. But it is important to get into those spaces. Right? And I think depending on where I go and what happens, yeah, it'll look different. It'll probably look similar to this in a lot of spaces. That doesn't mean, A, like we said, that those people aren't present, those people that we're talking about. And also, it doesn't always have to be that. Sometimes this is fine too. It just has to be all. It just has to be all. For me, I think large scale, do we need a more diverse group of black people in most rooms? Yes. But in my case, I'll just go to you. So if this space looks like this, cool. Then the next space needs to look completely different. And the next space needs to look like the kind of space that white people probably ain't gonna show up. Right? Not because they don't trust me, because they don't trust y'all.
Beginning comments, I was talking about like what I see as this growing like wave, like third wave of black cultural production, black thought, black activism. How have you had? Have you seen the same thing, or do you feel like something is actually happening? Not just with your own revolution of honesty, but with what you've been experiencing across the country?
I'm thinking, Carl, do I think this is real, this thing that we all know, right? Do this thing that we're going through, where all the shit has to be black, do I think that's real, where we're wearing all the, like, melanated t-shirts with the Nah Rosa Parks and the which one?
That, not just that. It's actually just something that's really happening.
Mm-hmm.
Not just wearing t-shirts. And
well, that's a lot of what's happening, girl. I mean, it's a lot of what's happening. So I have to be honest.
All right.
There's a lot of that, and I think it is supported by real shit. So. I think that that's out there. As I said, I'm concerned about that always because I know that we do this. We get mad and we start talking and we gonna do it and it's gonna be this. And then the economy changes. Then the game benefits us. I need you to make a commitment, not because you failed at the game and now you have nothing left but blackness to save you. Don't run here, because I see a lot of that. Because you can't get employed after you finished at their school. You like blackness now. That's the t-shirt. Not always, but that's where they start. There's some real people in t-shirts, too. I have a couple t-shirts. But not just because of that. You have to choose it before it gets to the point where there's nothing left but that. We have to choose it every day. And what I will say is, I don't know yet. I am hopeful, actually, this week. How about that? I'm hopeful now. How bad does it have to get before you see what's happening? Because we got to sit for 8 years feeling like shit was real good, and we know that it wasn't. Stop. Stop with that. It wasn't. Not one thing was for us. Not one thing, and we know that. White people need to know that too. No. Whole bunch of programs for everybody. Where now? Where now that we don't have to sit complacent, thinking we've accomplished a thing? I'm excited about it. For white people too. Yeah, for white people too. Is this it? Do you feel it? Do you get it? Do you see it? Is it obvious that you have an inexperienced, racist, sexist, homophobic, xenophobic, all the words from school, all of that orange man who is being blatant with you? Do you get it now? What does it take? What will it take? I don't know with black people. I don't know what it'll take. I don't know what it'll take, Carl. Carl, I don't know what it will take. It should be now. It should be now. So I'm fucking inspired. Yeah, we needed this. I'll own that. We needed this. To get involved. And the unfortunate part is that there are children who will now be called all these things blatantly, who will feel like the world is against them. It is. It just is. We can't shield everybody from the reality of this. In some communities, they literally can't, because that's a privilege to think that you can go around and shield us from this. There are communities where that's not happening. Black parents are having that conversation every day, actually. It is a privilege to sit here and say, I wonder what will happen now. It's been happening. It's been happening. Do we see it now? I don't know. I hope so. But I tell you what, and you can tell everybody, I woke up that morning like, all right, let's go. Let's go. Let's stop with the games. Let's stop with yet another person who's okay, who's going to lie to us, who's going to use us and not care at all. I don't care about your bullying. No, I will not. I did not. Because we needed this. It's not my fault either. How about that? It's not my fault. Bush, people were out in the streets. We about to be out in the streets. White people, that's you too. Yeah, it's time, it's time, it's time. Donald Trump's in there. It just started. It just started. People are always on the streets the first week.
All right.
What are they doing in 3 weeks, Carl? What are they doing when it's not on television? What are they doing when they don't get to be interviewed? I'm using that Jillisblack voice for you. What are they doing next week? What about when it's not popular and new? Will they be there? We will see. Will we be there? We will see. Will they give us jobs? Will they give us scholarships? Will they give us grants? Will it shut us up? We'll see. What I do know is I'm excited to see. I'm excited to see now that it's so obvious what we're up against. Oh, you hate us. And there's no other way around it now. No complacency. No, he'll get it done. No, that's good. What now? I'm excited, Carl. You should be too. We should all be. Good.
So what do you view as the white people's role in getting the conversation going? Because a lot of what you're talking about comes from personal experience, but you grew up in a different world than what I live in.
Absolutely. That's what I'm talking about. Right.
I drove home and I was good. I was scared, but that's not the experience that I have.
Right.
So how do we contribute to that in a meaningful way that allows us to talk about it and not coming from that background?
Mm-hmm. Talk to white people. Talk to white people. And I think it's the entitlement. It's the entitlement to our spaces. I am angry when you comment. I do think it's a waste of an opportunity for a black person to get to say something. When you DM me, I do think, did you take a second and think, with what you assume I'm getting in my inbox, that I would take time here instead of with a black person? Think about that. And then talk to white people. If you are here, great. So there's a reason. Are you actually, because you can be honest too, are you actually talking to white people? Are you referencing articles that you've read? That wouldn't appeal to me if I was white. I'd be like, great, you read a Facebook article. That's awesome. Are you actually talking? And furthermore, are you following up by ending those relationships? Is it punitive? Is it punitive to be a racist? My uncle says like some crazy shit, but no, don't talk to him. Black people, we have to do this all the time for all sorts of reasons. For some systems that you gave us that might create some other types of phobias that might do that, we have to do this all the time. It's not good enough. It's not good enough. Your friend who's always, no, stop that. You don't need a Facebook article. If you're already here, then you understand what you have to do. And that is something punitive. There's no consequence to being racist. Create one. They won't have your friendship. They won't have your support. Do you understand we live in a country where really there's no consequence to it now? It's encouraged. We got to do something that says, if you are this person, this happens. Black people have that. So what's the consequence? Because don't just tell me that you're trying to educate. Show me the result. And the other thing is, don't tell me to do it. You know. You don't need my ideas. You don't need my life experience for that. You see it. We see it. White people, come on, you see it. This is ridiculous. This is ridiculous. Y'all acting a goddamn fool. It's ridiculous. It's not okay. Make a consequence. If you do not consider yourself racist and you know someone who is, don't talk to them. Try. Hey, I think it's really messed up when you say all black people, yes, I'm gonna continue saying all white people, all black people are like this. No, it's not. Stop talking to them. They can't grow from that experience. You're just wasting your time. Make it punitive. Black people know that. We've tried to educate them. It doesn't work. Try it. You get it or you don't. Because also, be honest, it's obvious. And they have the information too. And if you can understand Harry Potter, and know everything about it, it shows me that you're not interested in me, that you don't know anything about me. You know everything about Games of Thrones, games, multiple, that fucking zombie show, I don't know what the fuck y'all watching. You know everything about that.
Right.
You're writing fan fiction for that. You're disinterested. You don't care. Listen to an R&B station one day and not to make your own. Try it. See what you can do. See what you can do alone. And then that way, when you show up to a black person, what you can say is, here's what I've done. Oh my God, revolutionary. I've never had a white person come to me in the DMs and say, here's what I've tried. Can you help me? You start. I've been reading your posts. I've been watching your videos. Now I'm ready, tell me how. No, you haven't earned me yet. You haven't earned a black person yet. Try it, and then a black person might be more apt. It's like when, you know, your guardian, your parent says to you, you try it first, and if you can't do it, then I'll help you. You try. Tell us what you come up with. You might be sitting on something revolutionary. We don't know yet. You have life experience too. It's like when I tell people, when I'm talking about colorism, there's a secret to that. there's a secret to the fact that light-skinned people get together and talk about being light-skinned together. Oh no. Did I just tell? Oh, it's so hard to be done. And I talk. And when I reached 28,000 followers, all of the light-skinned women who also had about 28,000 followers started following me in a group. I get it. I have to say that about a privilege that I benefit from. Tell us what white people are saying. What are you saying? Give us the intel. What's going on? What's actually, what are you saying? Because you're not being honest either. We know you're having secret conversations. Maybe not you, but you know, you. What's going on? Y'all aren't being honest either. Nobody's saying it. I don't even know what kind of racist you are because you're not telling me. I have blatant racists in the comments who are still holding back. I can tell. Because there's stuff I would say. I'm like, God, you missed a huge part of this. I would have analyzed the shit out of this. You just meant fine. Just try it. Are there secret conversations? Are you letting people know? Because I'm not going to perpetuate colorism. I'm not going to engage in little conversations about how hard it is, because that's bullshit. I'm not going to engage in conversations saying, I don't really want to be like, I'm not going to do that. So I don't want to hear the same ones about, it's, you know, I don't really want this like privilege. Yes, you do. Of course you do. Why wouldn't you? Did you want to be arrested for the weed in the car? No. Right. Say it. Say it. I don't want that. So I'm not helping. But you can help. By talking to white people and giving them consequences. And when you come to a black person and say, I did 10 things. I did 10 things. Here's what they are, Jill. Do you know how much better that would be for me? Anyone, do you still have something?
Yeah.
First,
I'm so ready to be made felt uncomfortable, and this is really good, and thank you.
Mm-hmm.
And second, I'm not going to pretend that like everything's fine in Indianapolis, but when you mentioned Clumps, I went to high school, that's where my family lives, and instead of, I feel like there's this folk, like, that's where, I had two black people in my class,
mm-hmm.
and there's this deep-seated hatred towards Hispanics and,
mm-hmm.
and minorities, and I was outed and then shunned, like, but then I left and never went back and talked to people anymore, and then I live here and try to surround myself with as many diverse people as possible and
mm-hmm.
just pretend like they don't exist anymore, and now, was also when I was like, oh my God, I'm shocked that this happened. And
mm-hmm.
then I look and like, I just pretend they don't exist.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what I'm saying, but when you say talk to white people, my community,
mm-hmm.
I own my community, and
mm-hmm.
the fact that my community was the one that I pretended didn't exist, and now
mm-hmm.
this idea that I have to go back and
mm-hmm.
talk more.
Yeah, we get these distractions called like, personalities and differences and things, and ultimately, yeah, that's our community, right? It's your community. I think I would say the same thing I would say to black people in this case, which is that you're assuming that they're different than you. They might be reacting to different things than you. But I also tell a story about how white people were much nicer to me in the South. They knew what my community looked like. White people in the South know what black community looks like. They interact with it all the time. It's very similar. They know what that looks like. They're doing better than liberals. If they're reacting, I trust them more. I see the difference with conservatives coming to the comments and saying, I'm mad at you for saying this. That makes sense to me. That makes sense to me. Of course you are. That's a reaction I understand. What I don't understand is, I've been following you for a while, and I didn't want to say anything, but why do you think you're so different? Because they rejected an identity? That's reactionary. There's not that much difference. There's not, in terms of understanding blackness, there's not, right? Because these same things where we're saying like, well, white people are suffering too, sure. So, okay. But what is the actual difference in terms of knowledge? What is it? I'm asking. Right. You simply interact with it differently. Doesn't mean there's more knowledge of black people. But, yeah, if you are still Facebook friends with some of those people, make consequences for them too, right? We often talk in the black community about the fact that black people leave. We go to cities and we leave these areas behind. The South is ours. South is black people's, but we can't go. That's where all of our shit is. That's where all of our communities are. That's where we started. Right? If we'd go back, what would happen, I wonder? Where they have black shit. But we don't feel safe there. And we go to these cities and we don't talk to those people anymore. Why? Because then you wouldn't be shocked about Trump. And the other thing is you may even understand why, which white people seem very desperate to do right now. We know why. Find out why. I bet you that will give you a lot of information. So, I have a plane at some point. So is there anything else? Let's end on a black person. See how that did? I've heard from someone go right here.
Her question might be more interesting than mine. Go ahead.
I didn't have a question. Look, I just want to say, shit, thank you. Because, I don't know, like, just living back in Indy, you know, we have, the black arts community is so fucking dope here, but it's a lot of white spaces. So, mm-hmm. This is a white space. And I'm glad that the benefit for this space was you coming here and just letting us know, hey, you're here. And we appreciate it. Yeah, I don't have a question, though. No.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mine was just in relation to black women have been leading this conversation forever. Mm-hmm. So, where's the disconnect with black men coming to the table?
I was telling people last night that I am mostly written by black men. And they start out with about 78 or 79 paragraphs about how they're not trying to hit on me, which is great. That's what we've set up. So, hey, I just want to tell you right now, I'm not trying to hit on you right now. I just want to let you know that, okay, we get it. All right. That's who writes me. So I know that they're there. The other thing is I was saying that we do this thing, and there's this thing going on with black men right now. It makes me uncomfortable. Of some generalizations from inside. I understand where they might come from, and I also understand that they're problematic. So we do this thing, we have something called hoteps. I don't say hoteps because that would take the power out of a word that's not necessarily bad, so I say foteps. We have foteps, and we seem to be concerned about them. And some of the identities that they reject and some of the things that they do. And I understand that. And they're all up in the comments. But are we engaging them? Are we engaging them? Because my question would be, if we have a group that understands that this is a game, foundationally, which we say is the hardest part, to just wake up to and understand that this is bullshit and that it's a game. We say that that could take years. They got that. We throw that away every day. We don't expose them to anything. We make fun of them all over the internet. Like, that's what we do. That's how we handle it. My question would be, why are black people not engaging each other? I follow people who have followed me, who have been complimentary to me, black men who would identify that way. I follow and I wait. and I let them build up trust, and I build up some trust. And what's gonna happen is eventually I'm gonna go to the DMs and I'm gonna say, hey, I wanna talk to you about what you're calling the gay agenda. I wanna talk to you about that. Here's what I'm gonna do for you. I'm gonna tell you that I can understand why you think that that's a thing. I'm not afraid in my identity to say to you, I understand why that might look like that to you. Let's talk about that. And let me give you my story. Because how can you say all of these things about me and also think that I'm this person that you made up? But we're gonna talk about it. I'm not throwing black people away. I understand the frustration, but I have this platform now, and I will not be seen throwing black people away. I'm going to engage you. This is chaotic. There's probably a reason you think the way that you think. And as we sit and try to sift through all of the messaging, I can see how you would choose this and this and that. I get that. Because it just all looks crazy. It's an ableist word. It all looks like a lot. But I'm gonna say something about you and not try to talk to you? Since when, black people? Since when? That's not community. We can't have a revolution with the 12 people whose politics are completely 100% on point with our own. Right? Black men are there. They're all up in it, writing me all the time. Beautiful messages, poetic. They smile while they write them, I can tell. They're there. Black women, okay, so we can start some conversations. Maybe that's what we're skilled at doing. Who knows? That doesn't mean that they're not there. But it's a two-way street, right? And I also understand the trauma. I also understand when we get these articles about women getting shot in the club. I understand where this comes from. I can both understand where those feelings come from and still engage. I'm not denying all of that. It is traumatizing to have members of your own community say that you are all of these things. That is. I know, I get it every day. And I'm still gonna engage you. Because I'm still engaging whiteness every day. Really problematic ass whiteness. Every day I participate, but I'm gonna throw black men away. Come on now. Never. Never. Even as my father won't pay child support, never. I wish he would pay it now, because then I could quit this job. Anything else? Last one.
How do you deal with censorship? Because with your messaging, I know that you want to have to deal with screenings for it from the people you work with. And then also, you know, through social media, we all know that, like, the son of Baldwin, the account on Facebook, the issues that they've gone through and stuff like that. So how do you navigate censorship?
First of all, white people like me. They won't censor me. Instagram likes me. Let's be clear about that. They haven't taken anything down. They've never said shit, right? So there's all sorts of things going there. Understand that I get emails every day from white people looking to buy this. They're not ready to censor yet. They're looking to buy every day. I understand that you want to shut down messaging, but I also am not saying anything. The joke about all of this is, I'm not really saying a whole bunch of really deep stuff. There are pages that are worse. We all see them. They have a lot of memes on them. It's like a lot of like red, green, and all the, like, there's people doing the most on Instagram. I'm not that. As long as they think they can sell it. Not yet. That's the reality. Am I followed by people on Girls? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's a whole bunch of like little white celebrities who get to test their knowledge by following me. Right? So not yet. But I stay away from all of those words that we use that get us censored. Fine, I'll say it this way. It's the same. I don't deal with that. As far as at work, well, that's a whole nother story. They'll fire me. They will fire me. They will find a way to fire me. That's it. There is no way to deal with it there. They will figure it out. They'll be careful because they know that I have a platform. That's the reality. But as far as on Instagram, not yet. We'll see. We'll see. Son of Baldwin. Okay. I don't know what you, I don't know what's going on there. Facebook and Instagram are also very different in terms of platforms, in terms of social media. It's just very different. I'm hesitant about Facebook for that reason. Yeah, and you can hide on Instagram more than you can hide on Facebook. It, I mean, just speaking logistically, yeah. No, I was just there. Like, it used to just be a regular Instagram, I swear. Like, it was just like a personal Instagram, and then something happened. So, no, it's not why I chose it, but it's why I stay there. I get a little more of what I want. People have to find me more intentionally there. And I don't think that there are 50,000 people that agree with me in the exact same way. I think some of that is fluff. The more followers you get, the more watered down your messaging is. At some point, they will hit a point now where people are finding me, and I think that there's some authenticity to it. But that will stop. Some people are now just following because it's trendy. Right? And they don't really feel that way. I go on your page, it takes me 2 seconds. I'm like, there's no way. There's no way that you're actually agreeing with it. But we'll see. We'll see. Anything? I'm going to say a last thing. Okay. At the end of the day, I do think that we can. I use honesty because I think that we need it. That does not mean that I don't have hope for this. I use honesty because I have hope for this. Or else I'd be wasting my time. We can. And we can support each other in the meantime, right? But we have to engage, and we have to stop saying that if you didn't like an album, we're unfollowing you. I don't know, like, since when in human history has everybody liked one album? We used to have choices. I used to like Jeanette. Anyway, the point is like, we have to re-engage. We have to get ready for this work. We have a lot to be inspired by. As activists, we have to call ourselves that, and we have to get to work, but we can. Of course we can. But we're not gonna let the same people run this. We have to do our part to say, we are part of this. So if you feel excluded from this movement, then you don't understand the movement. And it won't move without us. It's the same 12 people who've been doing it for like ever. Like, we have to. So let's do it. Also, I'm selling t-shirts out in the hallway, so if you want to stay. Thank you so much for sitting here, for participating, for your questions. I appreciate you. I'm not selling this shit out. That's a promise. That's a promise. This does not end in some bullshit. I will not be on your television. If I'm on your television, I'm acting a fool. My promise to you, my revolutionary promise to you is you can fucking trust this. We've got to trust each other. I'm not going anywhere from this. If I wanted to be famous, I would have only made dating videos. I could have done it. I stopped them. Let's not be fooled. I have a lot more to say about dating, all which will lead you astray, but no, I'm really doing this, and I want us to really do this. I want us to really commit to each other, like actually. No, we have to do this work. Why would we get famous for doing our work? So no, I'm not gonna sell any t-shirts. I'm not. Not one. I can't have it. No. T-shirts for the rebel. So, no. And we all have to make that promise to each other. And I'm excited. I'm excited about the work that we get to do. I'm excited about getting to talk with Black people. And I also want to say, you don't have to agree with me. This is my life experience. This is all based on some things. You don't have to agree. You can disagree with any part of this. We just have to get to work. That's it. I don't know why you would disagree with this. Thank you for being here. Thank you for having me. Thank you.